Quasars, being among the hottest and brightest things in the universe, break their galaxies by heating them up too much and stopping star formation.
The universe is full of incredible objects that challenge the way we think about the world. We typically think of space as a large empty box containing objects like galaxies and black holes and stars. As it turns out, the physical forces of our universe lead to the creation of incredibly complex objects like quasars. The quasars are quasi-stellar objects. We observe them as very bright dots on our telescopes. But when we study them further, we find out that they are extremely bright, extremely far away, extremely fast, and very small in size when you compare them to the amount of energy that they are emitting.
In the 1950s, astronomers noticed mysterious loud radio waves coming from spots all over the sky. They were dots like stars, but were seen in radio waves rather than visible light. Everything about them was strange.
This is the first description of a quasar. The astrophysicist Hong Yixiu noted that these radio galaxies that we're observing have an optical power, so emitting light thousands of times brighter than normal galaxies. He called them radio galaxies because they were emitting lights mostly in the radio range and not in the light range. Astrophysicists could explain the presence of so many waves in the radio range by two different ways. One, there is a new kind of object in the universe that is emitting only in these radio frequencies. Or two, the object is so far away from us that its normal emission of light waves that we would see with the eye is shifted towards the radio waves. And it's not just shifted a little bit where it would appear a little bit more red to us, it is shifted by a lot because the object is so far away.
The only explanation was that they must have been so distant that their apparent speed was actually the expansion of the universe moving them away from us. But these enormous distances meant that quasars couldn't just be stars, but the active cores of galaxies billions of light years away.
A massive object moving at over 30% the speed of light is a wonder. An astrophysicist explaining with the notion of a cosmological redshift. We know that the universe is expanding so that things are stretching further apart from each other. If you imagine a fabric of material that you are stretching, every bit of material in the fabric is staying still, but because you stretch it, they move further apart from each other. This action of stretching things apart, of expanding the universe, leads to a shift in the electromagnetic wave. So instead of observing the radiation wave at the frequency at which it was emitted, we see it at a different frequency. And if the object is moving far away from us, because the universe is expanding, we see a shift toward more reddish color in the frequency spectrum. We call this a cosmological redshift. If the thing was moving closer towards us, we would see what we call a blue shift, because the object would appear more blue than it is in reality.
There's only one way to generate the vast amounts of energy a quasar shines with: feeding supermassive black holes. We still don't know how exactly they formed, but it seems that every galaxy has one in their center. But how can the brightest things in the universe be black holes, which trap anything and everything that crosses their event horizon?
That's not exactly true. Some galaxies, like our Milky Way, do not have a quasar at the center, they have a normal black hole. A quasar is a supermassive black hole with a disk of matter surrounding it. We call this disk an accretion disk. And the reason there is so much light is because the supermassive black hole is feeding on the particles. But as the particles are moving around the black hole and being absorbed towards it, they collide with each other and they create friction, which creates heat and energy. A vast amount of energy is emitted by these particles as they are moving towards the black hole, and that is what we get to see. And we are talking about black holes so massive and amounts of matter so huge that the energy emitted can travel from the early universe, very, very far away, to us today. So I would like to show you two pictures of quasars to give you a sense of the situation. The first picture is a classical type of quasar that is 1.5 billion years away from us. It is surrounded by a galaxy that it created, and we can see the arms of the galaxy rotating around it. Now, these arms exist because the galaxy is rotating around the quasar, but they are not really arms. They are more like galactic density waves. If you imagine on water, when the waves come higher up, at that point in time, you have more water. and another wave goes down, at that position you have less water. Well, the same thing happens inside galaxies, where waves travel throughout the galaxy, but instead of having a wave going higher up, we see a higher density of stars because they are closer together. And that is what we see as arms in a galaxy. It's also a very cool topic of astrophysics that we can discuss by playing with bubbles in beer, but that would be another topic. So let's move to another quasar. This quasar doesn't have a galaxy surrounding it. Astrophysics thinks that it comes from an exotic object in the universe that was a supermassive black hole that encountered a normal galaxy without the supermassive black holes. And this supermassive black hole, or this exotic object, absorbed the galaxy, leading to the creation of a quasar. And on the picture on the bottom right, you can see a star that is much closer to us. And on the top left, you can see a galaxy that is being distorted and slowly approaching the quasar in question. And it's because the supermassive black hole is feeding on the galaxy it's destroying that we see so much light emitted and that we have a quasar. It's one of these galaxy killers that Kurzgesagt is talking about, because it is literally killing an otherwise existing galaxy.
Okay, maybe killing is a bit of an exaggeration. A galaxy is still there after its quasar turns off, but it will never be the same again. Quasars, being among the hottest and brightest things in the universe, break their galaxies by heating them up too much and stopping star formation. While hot things like quasars and supernovae tend to push gas out of the galaxy, shockwaves and quasar jets can also compress gas, making new stars at least for a short time.
Quasars lead to complex interaction. While a black hole just absorbs matter, a quasar also has a lot of physics surrounding it and creating a lot of complexity. And while a quasar and black hole is feeding on a galaxy and destroying and incorporating its matter, it also emits massive amounts of energy that are going to lead other spaces of the universe to collapse on themselves and create new objects.
But there is also more ingredients. In order to create a galaxy, we need to create stars. Stars are made of compressed gas, but the problem is that to compress gas, we need more than gravity. If it was only for gravity, the clouds of gas would just rotate faster and faster as they compress. So this invisible ingredient of the magnetic fields that removes some of the angular momentum.
Quasars and matter and radiation wave around them. And this allows the dust that is in the universe to be pushed together to collapse and to form new stars and new galaxies. Quasars can also emit jets of matter and energy that are extremely powerful and span hundreds of thousands light years. This jet ends up shaping deeply our universe. But the shaping of the universe is a complex topic that I'm not gonna brush today. We could do it in another video. It's a very cool how a few laws of physics and the evolution of the universe can lead to such a variety of complex and fascinating objects. And one of these objects is the physics of quasars.
And this is the start of the paradigm we use to interpret all of this activity. It's not just a black hole, it is a supermassive black hole, much more than you get just from one massive star collapsing down. And all the different manifestations of activity are due to the activity going on round this black hole. So, to explain, by the accretion of matter falling through the gravitational field onto a supermassive black hole, you can liberate the rest mass of that material. Here's your second equation, okay? Really likes this one, E equals mc squared.
Side note, but I have a crush on Professor Caroline Crawford. Her talk is fascinating. So quasar also poses an enigma. How come that galaxies accumulate more mass over time and therefore become brighter, but we see these very, very bright objects early in our universe? And the answer is that the universe back then was much smaller than it is now, and so matter was a lot more condensed, which gave more matter to quasars that they could feed on.
10 billion years ago, the universe was about a third of its current size, so the intergalactic medium was much less spread out, meaning the filaments of gas around quasars could feed them a banquet. The brightest quasars power jets, tangling the magnetic field of the matter around them into a narrow cone. They launch enormous beams of matter out, plowing through the circumgalactic medium, forming plumes of matter that grow to hundreds of thousands of light years in size.
Quasars are absolutely essential component of the creation of our galaxies, but they remain highly mysterious objects because of all the physics involved. One of the big open questions is that we observe quasars still existing today, but we don't seem to observe new quasars being created. We observe the creation of new black holes when stars collapse on themselves, but to observe the creation of a supermassive black hole being created and one that also had a high amount of matter surrounding it seems like a very rare occurrence, now that that universe is super spread out. But that might change in the future, because our Milky Way, our galaxy, is going to collide with the galaxy Andromeda.
And as dormant as it is now, Sagittarius A star could turn into a quasar in the future. In a few billion years, the Milky Way will merge with Andromeda. When galaxies merge, so do their supermassive black holes, sinking into the center of their new galaxy, kicking up dust and stars in every direction.
There are so many more aspects of physics I could have covered in this video, but it's long enough, so I hope you learned something watching my reaction to the video of Kurzgesagt on galaxy killers, or quasars, and I will definitely do more videos on the topic because it's a lot of fun. So please like this video, stay tuned, and I'm really glad you spent this time with me.